Okay, so I hope I want to put you to sleep. Let's talk. So I'm going to talk about distributed machine learning. Before I talk about it, introduce myself. So my name is Anand. I'm a co-founder of a startup called Data. We're trying to build a data science platform. So we're trying to build a Heroku-like platform where we're trying to abstract out non-data science components so the data scientists can focus on data science. I also run advanced programming courses at People Academy, particularly do Python and advanced Python courses, Bangalore and around India. In my past life, I worked at a company called Sand Life Sciences, where we have built machine learning algorithms from scratch. I guess these years we can start pick Python, scikit-learn, R, and start doing things pretty quickly, but those days we had to actually start building things from scratch or write k-means, ironically clustering, support with questions, solve it yourself. So I've done those things there, and then I worked a couple of years at Internet Archive building scalable web applications. So this talk, I'm going to talk about, the motivation for this talk is, when you look at machine learning, traditional machine learning training takes a really long time. And trying to do on a distributed cluster is very scalable and it's very effective. The problem is, the existing tools are not so easy to use. Okay. So I'm trying to figure out, is there an easy way where, to do distributed machine learning? So, I really love simple interfaces. For example, take programming. I'm a big fan of Python. So print hello world, that's all you need to write, hello world program. Look at scikit-learn for machine learning. Take any model, fit with the training, and predict, got prediction out. Right? So simple interface. Now, how do you deploy machine learning models? Couldn't really find anything, so I built a small tool called Firefly. So what you do is, you take your Python model, Python module, and then function name, and say Firefly that, it starts running a RESTful API that you can use it outside. So it's an open source tool that open source library that we built recently. And we started looking at distributed machine learning. What simple interface to do distributed machine learning? We couldn't really find anything. Okay. So we thought, let's experiment that and see if we can build something, if it seems something possible to build something like that. So, so we tried some experiments and talked about summary of what are the state of the art tools available to do distributed machine learning and something about whatever the experiments that we have done. So, if you typically look at traditional machine learning workflow, you do data preparation, feature extraction, and you train your models. And part of the training models, you do something called hyperparameter optimization or a grid search. What you do is you try to find best model through a set of parameters that you specified. So it goes through all the parameters, all the combinations, and tries to give you the best model possible. So it tries to go through all possible combinations and gives you the model with the best performance. It's going to take a really long time to do one. If you have a large data set, that's what people do, right? So that's that's a cut for programming, but it's the same code compiling is much model is building. Right? So that's what people do, right? People sit at screens and wait for them to finish. How do you speed it up? Right? I think it's very important to speed it up so that people do something more productive than sitting at screens or doing something like that. So there's a great opportunity here to parallelize grid search. There are more things that can be parallelized, but grid search seems to be the low hanging fruit because that's you're giving a set of parameters and then you're trying to build a model for each one of those parameters. So it seems to be a low hanging fruit to parallelize. So we thought, let's pick this up and see if this can be run on this particular cluster and see what it takes to do that. So before actually getting to understand how those things work, let's briefly look into what the parallelization patterns are there to understand how that things actually work. So there are two kinds of parallelization patterns. One is data parallelism, and another is task parallelism. So when you say data parallelism, this is what it happens. So what you do is you look at so you have your input data, you slice that data into multiple parts, and then you run the same task concurrently on multiple cores or distributed way, and then you get an input data, and then you probably run another task in the same way, and then you get the final output. So what you're getting is here, you have input data, and then there are multiple processes working, all doing the same thing with different sets of data. So this is called data parallelism. And there's a couple of examples of that. Look at the GPU. What it does is it runs the same instruction, but it runs 100 cores or 1000 cores, whatever. Then each gets a different data. So it's a single instruction, multiple data patterns. So that's a classic example of data parallelism. And if you've ever done parallel programming, there's a library called OpenMP and MPI. OpenMP is for parallelizing things on an SMP and a computer with multiple cores. The MPI is a message passing interface to do the same thing on distributed cluster. If you look at Apache Spark, the ML algorithms are data parallel. So what they do is they take the data, slice it, and then run it on a cluster. take MapReduce, the map of MapReduce, what it does is takes the data, slices that, and then runs it on multiple machines. So that's a data parallel example. Now let's try to understand what is task parallelism here. So when you look at task parallelism, what you do is you have input data for multiple sets of data, and you have different tasks. They can be executed parallel. They can take the same input data or different data, doesn't matter. But they can be run at the same time. So you can use run them on the same machine with multiple processes or in a cluster, and then they produce something output. So this is task parallelism. A couple of examples. A grid search is a classic example of task parallelism because you're trying to build a lot of different models. There are different parameters, but each one of is an independent task. And if you ever use a task queue like celery in Python, what it does is you have a queue of tasks to be executed. There are workers, they pick the task and execute it. So if you look at the data parallelism, task parallelism, data parallelism is usually very fine grained. So you have very small micro tasks. This task parallelism task usually bigger. So the task parallelism can even have tasks that take minutes or even hours. So now that we know what are different parallelism patterns, let's try to go back to our grid search and see how do you parallelize grid search. Okay. Now, well, frankly, you really don't have to do much to actually parallelize grid search because grid search has an option. It's basically how many jobs you want to run. That runs so many workers and actually tries to parallelize that for you. But the limitation is, you're limited by a single computer. So, if it has four cores, it runs four cores, but if you really want to do even more, that doesn't really work. So, is there a way we can actually enter multiple computers? That's what we're trying to see if that's possible. Now, why do you really want distributed machine learning? The reason is, if you run machine learning on a cluster or a lot of computers, the advantage you get horizontal scaling. So, let's try to understand this term, horizontal scaling and vertical scaling. So, when you say vertical scaling, what you do is you ask for, give me a bigger machine. Once you scale up, you say, give me even bigger machine. There's a limit on how big a machine you can get. Whereas in horizontal scaling, what you say is, say, give me more machines. You don't say, give me bigger machine, but you say, I want the same machine, but I want more of them. That's very easy to get. So, when you are an organization, you're trying to grow up, it's not easy to get a lot more machines than same machine. One machine with very large size. So, horizontal scaling is good, and we're trying to see if we can do that for our machine learning. Now, there are already available solutions. So, if you look at Apache Spark, it's a very good tool for doing distributed ML. But the problem is, you can't use the tools that you already use. You can't use scikit-learn, for example. But use Spark's ML libraries. So, if you're already experienced with, let's say, scikit-learn or something, you can't translate the same thing to Spark and start learning all things again. There's another library called datasets that's really a very interesting library. It supports multiple backends, it supports threaded process or even distributed backends. So it's very flexible computing library. But again, so how do you do distributed computing with even Spark or Dask? There are a lot of challenges, right? So the challenge is, it requires setting up and managing a cluster of computers. It's not a trivial job for a data scientist to do. You need to have an IT team to set up, and then you run something, and then how do you start things on demand and stop on demand, right? So you're kind of very underutilizing resources. You have a cluster set up for you, but you only run it for very few hours in a day, so really underutilizing those resources. So our question is it really possible to have a simple interface that a data scientist can manage on his own or her own? So we're trying to see if that is possible. So we did some experiments in this. So what we did is we built, as part of our work to simplify data science, or abstract away the data science, non-data science components in the data science workflows, we built a compute platform. So the platform, what it does is, you can say, I want to run this program, and then say, this program I want to run, starts a job, the cluster, and then starts running it. You can specify what instance type that you want. You can say that I want to run it on a machine with 8 GB RAM or 16 GB RAM. You can also specify what environment that you want to run it on. You can say, I want to run it on Python 3, TensorFlow 1.2, or Python 2.7, scikit-learn. So it will pick the right environment, and then runs the job there. Behind the scenes, what it does is, it picks an available machine in the cloud, or starts a new one if nothing is available. It runs a Docker container with appropriate image, expose any ports required. For example, you want to run a notebook, you have to expose and get a URL, access that. It manages shared disk space so that if you're running multiple jobs, you can have shared storage between them, etc. Let's say, for example, you want to run something, a training on 16 core machine. All you have to do is say, run job, tell the instance type of one 16 core thing, and then there you go. So it's running on 16 core machine with all 16 cores maxed out and all those processes running there. Okay. So it's a simple abstraction. What you do is run a job and say what instance you want to say, and it runs in there. So we built this already. Now what we're trying to do is, now that we have this infrastructure with us, can we take this and see distributed machine learning on this? So what does it take? Can we build a simple interface to do this? So so what we've done is first, we built a low-level tool with a similar, familiar Python interface. So Python has a concept called pool. So you can have a pool of threads or pool of processes. So you can see multiprocess.pool, which gives you a pool of threads or processes. And you can submit, you can map job on it. So for example, let's say you're trying to compute a square of 100 numbers or a million numbers. What you can do is you can create a pool and then map, and then gives you results back by running them on that. So what we've done is we're trying to create a distributed pool. So distributed pool n equal to 5, what it does is it creates n jobs in the cluster to start taking the work from this, and then executes that, and then it gives the result back. So this runs on the same compute platform that we've built. Now that we have basic tool to run distributed learning, so what we try to do is we try to do the scikit integration. So we wrote a small wrapper to provide our own implementation of GridSet CV. What it does is it takes, instead of using GridSet CV from scikit-learn, we use GridSet CV from the library that we have. That would, what it does, it uses the distributed pool that we have used in the backend, in slide before, and then starts running jobs on that. So, if you see, we don't have to really do any cluster setup or anything. Just start using it. This code you can run in a notebook or a script, etc. So it starts creating the jobs and runs it, and then you get your results back. So that one is, I think, is the simplicity. I really, like the first slide I said, simple interface are really good, like Python scikit-learn. So try to achieve a very simple interface, and this kind of show that simple interface is possible. There's no manual setup required because the platform takes care of everything. It works in familiar interface, you can run things from notebook, etc. If you want to really save your costs, you can say run this on spot instances because the platform supports that. So without any additional setup, you can actually reduce your cost by running on AWS spot instances, etc. So I just we're really trying to even see if you can extend this to other things. We're looking at things like, if you look at an ensemble model, there are multiple models packed into one. So when you're training something like that, we're trying to see if it's possible to run each of this model independently in the cluster so that you can get even more scalability. We're trying to see if you can extend this to distributed machine learning, not only scikit-learn. So I think our implementation is kind of, we have proof of concept implementation of trying this thing. I think what we've done is we've got the interface is really right, so it's a very simple interface, people can use it. I'm sure the implementation you have can improve, will improve over time, but I think we really got the API really right. And the summary is, so if you look at, so with large data sets, etc. The distributed learning will be more effective than single computer mode because you can scale up as much as you need. And also, if you actually look at the business side, abstracting away the complexity of distributed learning or any data science workflows, infrastructure, etc., will improve time to markets a lot, right? So you don't have to wait for the months to set up a cluster or get everything working together, etc. So to kind of have a system which abstracts a lot of infrastructure components and lets you do distributed machine learning with very, very simple interface. So that's all I have, and open to questions.
Hello. Hi.
Can't see.
This side.
There?
Okay. I don't know.
Yeah.
Hi, this is Paridhi from American Express, and we do have a lot of data to build models on, and this is exact framework that we are also looking at. My question is that when you are doing a modeling on about terabyte of data, you need that distributed machine learning framework to build the model in the first place.
Okay.
The problem is that the accuracy of the model has to be maintained when you are implementing a distributed version of machine learning algorithms. In your version, how do you make sure that Gini index or precision is always maintained even when you are using distributed ML version?
So let me clarify one thing. See, here we're not really doing anything about machine learning, right? So all we are doing is we are streamlining the infrastructure part. Okay, we're trying to provide a simple implementation, simplifying the infrastructure part, okay? So the machine learning algorithms, I mean, whether you run the same thing on a in a single machine or a cluster, we're not really tweaking any of these algorithms. So you get exactly the same accuracy or performance that you get in a single machine. You get the point? Yeah, so I can probably take it offline, yeah.
Here is one question.
Which side?
Right here on the top.
Okay.
So the question is, I was a little surprised that you did not mention, for example, TensorFlow or BigDL as one of the choices for implementing distributed machine learning. Any specific reason or did you just restrict to only Spark and that?
No, so the thing is now, as I pointed out, so we're trying to abstract out non-data science components. Okay, we want to give the choice of what algorithm to use to the data scientist. Okay, so we're not really trying to change the way people do data science, but we're trying to see how people can run things fast, etc., without really changing their workflow. So it's a choice is to use TensorFlow or scikit-learn is to the data scientist who is working on. Okay, so and we're trying to start it with scikit-learn. We're trying to extend that to deep learning, so we will probably go and look into TensorFlow after this. Okay. So I think the key thing is we're not really trying to make a choice of what's a good library to use. It's the data scientist who decides what library to use, and we're trying to make it faster with tools that we're building.
Hi.
Thank you very much. I am afraid we do not
have time
for any more questions. Our next speaker. Sorry.
Excuse me. Hi.
I'm sorry, we are finished with questions.
I think
we'll
take
have
questions.
To take your questions offline.
I think we take questions offline.
Yeah.
So I'll be hanging around.
This is only a 20-minute talk, so there's not a lot of time for questions. I'm so sorry. Thank you, Anand. That was really interesting.
Thank you.
So our next talk is a 30-minute talk, which also doesn't have a lot of time for questions, but a little bit more. What do you do when the usual open source suspects like Hadoop and Spark don't work for your project? You could go find another one, or you could build something yourself that works better.